the person sitting next to me bumped my shoulder like that, and she goes, Jess, she's scared. And I said, she should be scared.
What's up,
you guys? Welcome to today's video. So in today's video, I'm going to be doing another video in my Locked Up With series. It's been a minute since I made one of these videos, so I'm going to try to remember, if I forget, remind me, to leave a playlist of my other Locked Up With videos in the description box down below. Today's video is very serious. It is one that is very difficult for me to talk about because I cannot comprehend how a person can do such a thing. Now, I've met a lot of lifers in my life, but this was the only time that I remember seeing somebody get sentenced to life while I was in county jail, a female that I was in a pod with anyway. So if you are new to my channel, my name is Jess. I'm a recovering addict who served time in prison. I will leave more information about my story and my journey in the description box down below, as well as my second channel, my podcast, my Patreon, all of that is linked down below. Without further ado, let's go ahead and get started. Now, I tell a lot of stories about my time in Arkansas because when I was doing time in New York, it wasn't a hard time, if I'm being honest. It sucked. I mean, it's definitely difficult, but it wasn't chain gang hard. It wasn't take your mattress away in solitary confinement, sleeping on a concrete slab hard. It was not fighting for feminine hygiene products hard or underwear. The time that I spent in Arkansas was the hardest time I've ever spent in my life, and doing time there is what made me want to fight for prison reform and talk about prison reform and share these stories with you guys, because that time was traumatic, gut-wrenching, something that I still am recovering from, if I'm being honest, because my daughter was born while I was in prison, so it was a very difficult time for me. The people that I'm about to discuss in this video are evil. I mean, there's no other way to say that other than they are evil. And this was a very difficult case for me to wrap my head around and also be locked up with these women. So let's just get into the crime, because I'll sit here and ramble and cry probably. But let's talk about the crime. So two women and one man had babies. So three individuals, between the three individuals, had two babies and nine dogs. Both women had a baby around the same age. One baby was 2 months old, the other baby was 2.5 months old. And I believe they lived together. If they didn't live together, then they certainly spent a lot of time together, and the babies were not taken care of. That is the easiest way I can say that. The babies were only fed once a week, according to court documents. They were starving, they were so hungry, they had dropped below their birth weight at 2 months old, so they were very, very, very little because they were not being fed. These three individuals had nine dogs on the property. The dogs were very well fed. In fact, there was food in the dog dishes when law enforcement showed up at this house. The dogs were completely fine, well fed, they looked like they had plenty of exercise, the dogs were in perfect health. And the babies were not. Not only were the babies not being fed, but there were tons of cans of formula at this house. It wasn't a case of they couldn't afford formula, because formula is freaking expensive. It was they had just chosen to not feed the babies, even though there was food in the house. Not only were the babies not fed, but they were also abused. One of the females involved in this case testified that she had broken her son's fingers and his arm. It was by far the worst child abuse case I had ever seen while I was doing time. And the reason why I had details of the case while I was doing time is because it was on the news and other women had seen it and they told me. These two women were arrested in February of 2011. I was arrested October of 2011. Then they were sentenced in 2012. So let me just talk to you about what this looked like on the day-to-day, like doing time with these women. One of them was so evil, so vicious, so boastful of the crime that she was not allowed in GP. That individual was kept in a solitary unit that only had like three cells for females, and just the way that the solitary unit was set up for females at this county jail was there was the pod where women are, then like this little officer's desk, and you could see into solitary. So one of the individuals, because she was so disgusting about the crime. She would taunt other inmates from the solitary unit, but she was kept there. We could see her occasionally, and she could yell out. Every time that we were leaving the dorm and we would pass the solitary little tiny unit of maybe three or four cells, she would yell to us. And it's crazy because she even knew what was going on in the larger unit, in the GP unit, because she was so close to us. She could hear conversations going on in vents, or she would, you know, hear the guards talking because the guard station was right there. So she had a lot of information on a lot of us. She knew my name because she had heard it. So she would taunt us when we walked through, or try to talk to us when we walked through, or sometimes try to be nice to us. The other woman was not boastful, and she got along with people in the GP unit, and she was allowed to be GP after a while because she had never brought up her crime, talked about her crime. If you were just passing through the county jail, you wouldn't know why she was there. It wasn't talked about that often because it got people upset, obviously. Especially me, and we'll get there. But if you were there fighting your case for some time, you know, if you were there for months and months like I was, you just know why people are there. At this time in my life, I would verify people that were hanging out with me, like Hollywood, which you guys will meet soon. I know I keep saying that, but she is gonna come on the channel very soon. The people that was in my social circle, I wanna know who I'm hanging out with. I know that statement gets a lot of criticism, like it's none of your business why she's in jail. It is, because I'm not going to help a chomo, feed a chomo, or a child abuser. They're not gonna sit at my table. They're not gonna cook with us. They're not going to do anything with us, ever. And that is just jail and prison 101. You can ask anybody. If you have that charge, you should not even be in GP. Okay, so that's why the first individual, because she was so boastful about the crime, was always kept there. I did have a couple of interactions with the woman that was in GP. I tried not to, but you know, there was one time where she asked me if I wanted to cut her in line, and I told her, no, I'll wait. I don't want your spot. I don't want your spot. I don't want you to do anything nice for me. I don't want you to talk to me, you know? So I just said, no, thank you. I was not confrontational with her or make a stand to get her out of GP because I didn't have time for it. I was pregnant. I had to focus on my own shit, my own case. But at the same time, she was not going to hang out with my circle. She wasn't going to cook with us. And I had made that known, you know, and justifiably so. The people that I hung out with also agreed. We had the same belief system when it comes to hurting children. So there was another time where I was going to court and she wished me well. And I didn't respond to that at all. You know, I kind of looked at her and was confused by that because we don't know each other. And for all intents and purposes, she was nice to me, you know? And it always threw me because she knew that I didn't want to associate with her. You know, you can tell if someone doesn't want to associate with you or talk to you or whatever, but she was still nice to me. And I think that's why she was allowed to be in GP, because she was nice to everybody, you know? And I've spoke to a lot of correctional officers that worked with the special needs unit. So chomos are housed in prison in a special needs unit on the men's side. I've talked to a lot of correctional officers that worked in those units, and they always say the same shit. They always say it's very calm over there. All of the chomos are nice to correctional officers. There's no drama. They're very kind and helpful. I just wanted to throw that in there because that's what I had always heard. But just to get back to the story, she was always nice to me, and she was nice to everyone else. That's why she was GP, which I always felt was so weird, because if I was a man, it wouldn't have gone down like that. That person would be in solitary and protective custody, and that is what it is, but it's different when you're a woman, you know? So I remember the day before she was going to court. The day before she was going to court, and this was the only time that she had brought up her case anywhere near of earshot to me, but I was eating at a day room table. And she came up to the table, and I didn't even pay attention at first. I was just writing to someone or something. I was very wrapped in what I was doing. She asked the person I was sitting next to if she could sit down because she was very nervous about tomorrow. She was going to be sentenced. Now, she had gone to court many times, you know, over the course of that week, and we all knew what time it was. We all knew that she was going to court. So the day before sentencing, she asked to sit down at the table. We knew that life was on the table, okay? So we knew that potentially she could get life. And when she asked to sit down at the table, the person I was sitting next to said, go ahead. Because she had, you know, sympathy for her, because this is a scary moment. You're getting life. And that caught my attention. And I looked up and I said, no, you can't sit here. And the person sitting next to me bumped my shoulder like that, and she goes, Jess, she's scared. And I said, she should be scared. She almost killed an innocent baby. Don't y'all have babies? And that was really the first time that I had taken a stand verbally and out loud. You know, no, you cannot sit next to me. I'm sitting here pregnant. And you want to sit at my table? I don't think so. You know, I was hormonal. I was terrified for my own situation because I don't know if I'm ever going to be the, I don't know if I'm ever going to get the chance to be a mother. And you had a chance and you almost took that child's life. No, you can't sit with me. She kind of did one of these and walked away. And then somehow I feel bad because I had to make a stand and say, no, you can't sit with me because you, right? Okay. So I go back to my cell. I know it's a stressful day for her. I go back to my cell. I don't need any drama, but my hormones boiled over. No, you cannot sit with me, right? So I just took myself out of the day room, took myself out of the equation. I don't need it. So I realized that I had snapped and I went back to my cell. I'm like 5 months pregnant, which means I'm 5 months sober, which means I'm hormonal. Okay, so I went back to my cell and I remember having a conversation with Hollywood about that. And she's like, yeah, it's messed up. It's messed up. You know, just take a breath. Don't stress yourself out anymore. Hollywood was there for me when I needed somebody to tell me, stop freaking stressing out. You know, you don't need this. You're pregnant. Lay down, relax. You know, if someone else told me just relax, it wouldn't have hit the same way. So I'm very grateful to have had a really good friend while I was in that situation, pregnant in jail and then eventually prison. So the next day rolls around and sure enough, she comes back with life. And I thought, why is she in GP? Like, why is she still here? It is the policy of that specific jail. I don't know how it is everywhere else, but it's the policy of Sebastian County Jail. If you get a life sentence, that you are kept on watch for like 48, 72 hours, whatever it is, to make sure that you are not going to attempt to harm yourself because you just got a life sentence. So I was expecting if she got life that she wouldn't be in GP, but they just let her do whatever she wanted in this jail. They just let her come back to GP. Like, she didn't just get life. And I'm not gonna ask the guard that because I only talked to the guard for mail and toilet paper or to bitch about other women not getting pads at that time. I didn't need them because I was pregnant, right? And I remember watching her walk in and other women asking her, well, what'd you get? She said life. And I'm like, no, she didn't, because she wouldn't be here. But the correctional officers in that jail allowed her to basically do whatever she wanted. They didn't even talk crap to her. She did whatever she wanted, was in GP, didn't have to segregate for a while after a life sentence was given to her. But in the same breath, those same guards treated me like trash because I was an addict. Treated me like trash. But this person that almost killed an innocent child can do whatever she wants. There were so many moments doing time there that I was just enraged. And this was one of those times, you know, where I kind of just saw them just give her a pass on all of their rules, but I could barely get to medical visits. I had to fight for prenatal vitamins, you know, so I was just enraged that she just kind of could do whatever she wanted and no one cared. And I'm over here like, can I just get a vitamin? Can I just get some clean water though? And they're like, shut up, inmate. So that was by far one of the worst crimes that I had ever heard of. And then to see someone get a life sentence in county jail. I have met tons of lifers and I've heard some crazy stories and I have known about some very, very dark and heinous crimes. But crimes involving children are the worst. They're the most heartbreaking. They're the most difficult to see. And I think that's the most common thing when people think of inmates. They think of those kinds of crimes. I just want to say this, that most inmates are there for drugs. Over half are serving time on a non-violent drug offense. A large number of the people serving time in prison on a violent crime did so because of drugs or to get drugs or it was somehow involving drugs. So in my personal experience with what I have been through, most people that I have seen are serving time for drugs. And then you get cases like this that just shock you and stay with you for the rest of your life. I will forever think about this case. I am very happy to say that those children did recover. It was a very long process for them. They went to foster care and they survived. I don't know how they are doing today. All I know is that thankfully they are alive. This is a hard video. This is a hard video. This is a heavy video. I'm a firm believer in I hear people's story for a reason, right? I was locked up there at that specific time for a reason. And all of the stories that I heard had an impact on me. As awful as this one is, it will always stay with me. And I cherish my children, I love my children, and I protect them at all costs. And I think a big part of that comes from hearing stories like this and seeing horrible crimes against children, because it's inconceivable to me that someone would hurt such an innocent little baby. Or animal cruelty. I mean, those are the worst crimes to me. So at least I made it all the way to the end without getting tears, right? So I'm gonna end today's video here. If you are a parent, hold on to that baby today and give them an extra hug. Because so many children do not have loving homes. I love you guys. Stay safe, stay sober, whatever that looks like to you. Hold on to those babies extra tight today, and I will see you in my next one.